Good evening, Rowan. It's the 4th of August 2017, and it's about a quarter to seven. And obviously, this is my usual Friday evening video to reassure you that I won't be seducing any priests over the weekend, so you can relax. Because obviously, I'm serving myself for my beloved, because he's so wonderful and we're made for each other. And we just can't wait to be together in each other's arms on our bed of roses, on our silk sheets, having a really good time the minute that you're out of the picture. We talk about it all the time. We're really looking forward to it. Anyway, another thing I won't be doing over the weekend is hanging around the Catholic parish of St. Urban's in order to bump into any pretend astrophysicists in order to save your skin. And nor will I be coming out as a lesbian in order to save your gigantic ego. So everything is exactly the same as usual. Anyway, I thought we could have a chat this evening about your attachment to institutions and how this came about. And when I talk about institutions, in the quite long section of an interview that was conducted on the 1st of July 2015, that we've just seen at the beginning of this video, you talk about being in love with your school. Now, I've never heard anyone say that they were in love with a school before, or in love with any institution for that matter, so that's quite an unusual thing. If someone's in love, it tends to be with another person. So, you talk about this very unusual childhood, shall we say? A very unusual childhood, although you frame it as if it were normal, but you do have a tendency to do this, don't you? You talk about your own experience, and because you don't really understand that other people are separate from you and have their own identity and ideas and experiences, that they're not merely ciphers in your world or characters in your novel where you're the author and you're creating reality. I think this is how you view the world, which I've mentioned before, that it's kind of a novel that's in your head and you're the author and you define everyone's character and how they're going to act and what the outcome is going to be in certain situations. And this is why you react with hysteria and confusion when things don't go the way that you want. And you seem to think it's your job to be forcing the characters in your novel to act in the way that you've decided that they would. And so you're kind of globalizing your own childhood experience and your family life as if this were the same kind of experience that everyone would have. And you describe a quite eccentric sounding family, shall we say, as if that were normal in village life in Wales. And the only thing about it that sounds relatively normal to me is that your mother was adopted by an aunt, presumably because your aunt couldn't have children, your aunt and uncle couldn't have children. And that was a relatively normal thing for people to do when people had a lot more children before the age of contraceptives. If they had a sibling who couldn't have children, then that sibling would often adopt children from a brother or sister who had quite a lot of children already, so you would be killing two birds with one stone there. The children would have more resources, and the family member who wasn't able to have children would be able to have some children. So that was quite a normal thing to do before the contraceptive age and before the age of formal adoptions that are generally controlled by the state in the developed world. So that is the only part of your family life or nature, shall we say, that sounds relatively normal to me. The rest of it all sounds quite eccentric. And then at the end of that, having been very isolated in your family, which I'm going to say a bit more about in a minute, because you don't talk about that so much, in the interview, but there is more explanation of it in a biography that was written about you called Rowan's Rule, which was written by Rupert Short, which was first published in 2008. I've got the updated 2014 edition here, and I'm going to read a couple of paragraphs out of that to give some more information to that you'd already disclosed in this interview earlier on. So, first of all, your father's name was Anoiran and your mother's name Delphine, which is abbreviated to Del here. So, here I'm reading from this biography now, Rowan's Rule. Anoiran and Del, therefore, communicated in English most of the time. So, you're from a Welsh-speaking family, that's the context of this. Only shifting into Welsh when they didn't want Rowan to understand, a move that naturally stirred his appetite to learn the language. Now, we're talking about the 1950s here in South Wales, in the South Wales valleys, which were generally Welsh-speaking. And having lived in Wales and met people of the same generation as you and older, I do understand that it was quite normal at that time in many households for parents to speak Welsh when they were saying things that they didn't want the children to understand, because there was more of a thrust towards learning English, because I suppose you could even say that the world was becoming more globalised back then, and it was thought to be more advantageous for children to be learning to speak English and read and write in English, and this would open more opportunities for them in the future. So in that generation, Welsh tended to be spoken by parents when they didn't want the children to understand, in some families anyway. But what made that difficult for you was that you'd been ill and you were very isolated, so you were only experiencing life in your family, a lot of which was being conducted in a language that you didn't understand, that your mother wouldn't allow you to learn. So although it wasn't unusual that parents would speak Welsh when they didn't want the children to understand, it was more difficult in your case because you weren't interacting with other children either in English or in Welsh, and you talk about long periods of isolation. So I'm just going, that was just to set the context of that. So I shall continue reading now. So I've just read that your parents communicated in English most of the time, only shifting into Welsh when they didn't want Rowan to understand. You were an only child, by the way. A move that naturally stirred his appetite to learn the language. Now, this is a reason why I think you pretend to speak a lot of languages that you don't actually speak. So this book goes on. He remembers that his mother's sisters occasionally talked to each other in Welsh and that they always spoke Welsh to their mother. In due course, they resorted to English more and more, even in his father's family. Rowan detected a steady weakening of commitment to speaking Welsh all the time. On visits to Sydney and his wife Janet, conversation could be bewilderingly bilingual because Del and Anoiran moved in and out of Welsh within a single paragraph. Rowan remembers Janet especially as someone who was quite capable of beginning a sentence in Welsh and ended it in English, and who didn't seem conscious which language she was speaking for much of the time. Another consideration for Del was Rowan's fragility. Anything that was not going to make his life easier would be bad, and she reckoned that two languages were unnecessarily stressful. So your mother prevented you from learning Welsh, even though Welsh was a language that was being spoken around you a lot of the time, and you weren't allowed to communicate in this language, and you were isolated from other children and other people who would have been speaking English. So this book goes on. The trauma that would consume the family in February 1952, so you were born in 1950, was witnessed by Nancy Richards, one of Dell's oldest friends. When meningitis was diagnosed, Rome was taken to the Morriston Hospital in Swansea. His parents knew that he might die at any time. Having visited him every day, they usually stopped to see Mrs. Richards and her husband on their way home at bedtime. Dell described how Rowan's lumbar area had been punctured to release some of his spinal fluid and ease the pressure on his brain. This procedure was acutely painful. The infant screamed in terror every time he saw the woman doctor who performed it. Several weeks passed before he was felt to be out of danger. Then began the convalescence that would affect him for a very long time. The boy's early years were thus unmarked by the rough and tumble of a more conventional family life. For a while, this made his father's cousin Gwenda think of Rowan as a spoilt brat, but relations were soon patched up. So this book then goes on to talk about how your family moved to Cardiff when you were four, and that's where you first went to school. So in addition to being an only child in a Welsh-speaking family, in a Welsh-speaking area who wasn't allowed to learn Welsh, you were off school for a lot of time during primary school ages, so you weren't interacting with other children, you were very isolated. Your father was a very remote figure, and your strongest relationship was with your mother, who you describe as being very emotional and liking to be the centre of attention all the time. She also sounds very controlling as well, in not even allowing you to naturally pick up a language that was being spoken around you or could easily have been spoken around you, which you could have been encouraged to learn so you could at least join in with the adult members of your family rather than being completely isolated from everyone who you should have been interacting with had you not been so ill as a young child. And then your childhood was disrupted by moving away from a close-knit community in a village to Cardiff, which is the major city in Wales, the capital city of Wales, and then for secondary school moving back to Swansea, which is the second city of Wales, I suppose, in South Wales at least, anyway. So you had this very disrupted childhood, during which time you spent long periods of time very isolated from other children, from other members of the family and the community, with quite unusual parents, and a father who was very remote from you. So this, I think, is what leads to your confused perceptions of reality, shall we say, that you don't understand the difference between fact and fiction. You were reading obsessively, you say that yourself, during a time when you should have at least also have been learning about life from interaction with other people and with other children. You were overindulged by your mother. Maybe she would have done that anyway, I don't know, but certainly as a result of you being so ill and the fact that she didn't have any other children, she overindulged you, led a member of your father's family to thinking that you were a spoiled brat. And it does say in another article or biography about you that this relative, Gwenda, refused even to visit the house because she found your behaviour so objectionable. So during the period of time when you should have been experiencing primary socialisation, between the ages of 2 and 4, you were very ill, very isolated, being overindulged by your mother. And as a consequence of this, and the fact that this went on for an extended period of time as well, even into your primary school years, you don't seem to be able to distinguish between individual human beings and institutions, and it seems like your strongest relationships are to institutions. The way that you talk about being in love with your school, I've never heard anyone speak like that about any institution. And I also think this explains your attachment both to the church and to the state, that you talk about them both in parental terms. I've talked before about you making breast gestures at times when you're talking, and I've put some clips in later on in this video, which I've used in videos before, where you're making these breast gestures, quite clear breast gestures, while you're talking about the sacramental life of the church, God's self poured out. That's one thing that you're saying, what we can only think of as divine desire. And then also in another talk, you're talking about teaching meditation to children in schools, not particularly Christian meditation, just meditation techniques. And you're talking about coming close to the kingdom. In a Christian context, that would be the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven. But I'm not too sure that that's what you're talking about, because you don't specify it really. And I think you might be talking about the New World Order when you talk about the kingdom, or some other far more unwholesome state of affairs, shall we say. So you talk about receiving, capacity for receiving, and coming close to the kingdom, and you're making these breast gestures. So I'm getting the impression from this that you're seeing the church as a parent figure. I mean, this isn't unusual as a metaphor. People do talk about Mother Church and God as Father, and sometimes the symbol of Mother is used to talk about God as well. But I think you're understanding it rather more literally than that, that you're actually forming an attachment to this institution as if it were your real parent, and you're not understanding this in a metaphorical way at all. And I would say similarly, when you talk about the state, and what brought me on to making this video was once again the Harold Wilson lecture, which I've made my last few videos about, and I did comment on this briefly in my last video, and I've put two clips of that lecture in, which I covered in my last video. I'm just going to read them now, because I think you're talking about the state in parental terms. So here's what you say in the Harold Wilson lecture. I'll show the clips a bit later on. I hope that in the university and in civil society and elsewhere, we go on nurturing the capacity to ask profoundly awkward moral questions of our politicians while not expecting them to enforce our moral answers. And the second one, Christianity and other faiths have a profound and, again, rather paradoxical investment in the independence of the secular state. In the fact that politics is not all about morality, the role of the religious community, the theologically informed community in a democratic society, is to go on pestering a secular government not to do its will or enforce its judgment, but to allow its voice and to nourish debate. I've talked about both of those things in previous videos. But the point I want to reiterate here, in relation to what I've been talking about already, that you had this very disrupted and unusual and unhelpful childhood, and you seem to have attached yourself to institutions as if the institutions were literal parents, not even metaphorical parents, but literal parents. And this idea that the purpose of a religious community, or one of the purposes anyway, or one of the functions in a democratic society, is to go on pestering a secular government not to do its will or enforce its judgment, but to allow its voice and to nourish debate. It sounds to me like you're used to pestering parents and not getting anything back in response, like everything you were asking for was completely negated. So what is the point then of a religious community pestering a secular government if the government isn't going to take any notice? It's like the only thing that you're asking for is, I want you to hear me, but I don't even want you to implement anything about what I'm saying or even give me any room for conscientious objection or anything like that. Go on pestering the government not to do its will or enforce its judgment. Well, what's the point of pestering the government if they're not going to take any notice of what you say? There's no point to that. And it sounds to me a lot like this is just reflecting your experience of childhood, that you couldn't even talk to your family members, to the only people who were around you when you were ill, because they were speaking in Welsh half the time and you weren't allowed to learn Welsh, so you couldn't even talk to them properly the way you would have been able to grow and learn to talk in a normal family environment, or even if you'd just been able to go out and play with other children. So you don't even want your parents to do what you want or give you what you want or give you what you need. You just want them to listen to your voice. And I think this is what you're saying here in this quite unusual statement that you make about pestering a secular government, not to do its will or enforce its judgment, but to allow its voice and to nourish debate. And you're talking about the government and about the state as if it were a person, an individual person. And this, I think, as I've mentioned before, I think reflects your difficulty with abstract thinking, that you can't distinguish between actual things and abstract things. You talk about society as if it were a concrete thing. You don't understand it as an abstract, and that nothing is good for society that's detrimental to the individuals within it. And there's this great confusion around the nature of things, it seems to me, in your way of understanding the world. So that's actually the end of my video tonight, so it's quite a short video, and I'm just going to show these clips now of you talking about the church and about the action of God and making these breast gestures, and then also these two clips from the Harold Wilson lecture where I think you're talking about the state also as if it were a parent, and you haven't resolved all these conflicts from your childhood, and this is what's led you into this disturbed, confused state that you're in now and got you involved in all these nefarious activities. So I shall leave it there for now, because I really want to have an early night tonight so I can be dreaming about my beloved all night long, obviously, because he's so wonderful and we're made for each other. But don't forget to be alert, because I will be turning up to make a citizen's arrest probably after I've asked you a couple more awkward questions. The kind that you want religious communities to be asking politicians, allegedly. And I expect your wife is packing her bags already to be running off with her new Rastafarian boyfriend, who I bet is really hot. Hasta la próxima.
Second broad point, touching just a little bit on that very, very key question of how the sacramental life of the church comes to exist within lay-led communities and basically lay communities. Here, God's pressure to be in the world, God's will, God's self poured out in what we can only think of as a divine desire. Because we have, of course, in our education and our so-called maturation, skillfully and comprehensively trained ourselves out of receiving. Think about so much of what we
imagine education is about. But back to the central language of the kingdom and what's going on in the kingdom and what's going on in the person, young or old, who's somehow found themselves close to the kingdom. Interesting. Something of that receiving capacity has not been extinguished. And that, of course, does suggest to us, doesn't it, that it's pretty tough, it's pretty deep in us. Which takes me back to the point about this not being conveying an exotic skill, a mysterious extra, but facilitating that most important capacity to be where you are, who you are, in the kingdom which is where you belong. The kingdom promised by Christ. Christianity and other faiths have a profound, again rather paradoxical, investment in the independence of the secular state, in the fact that politics is not all about morality. The role of the religious community, the theologically informed community in a democratic society, is to go on pestering a secular government, not to do its will or enforce its judgment, but to allow its voice and to nourish it. I hope that in university and civil society and elsewhere, we go on nurturing the capacity to ask profoundly awkward moral questions of our politicians, while not expecting them to enforce our moral answers. And in that argument, that creative tension between community and politics, religious community and politics, moral community and politics, I think democracy will find its salvation.
That night when the Lord came home, inquiring of his lady, oh. The servant said on every hand, she's gone with the raggle-tackle gypsies, oh.
The footman memorized the number, but the prince still holds both his hands. A new dream of palace for a bed sits in Canterbury Tales.
best sex.
Adelante.
Oh, what care I for my house and my land? What care I for my money? Oh, I'd rather have a kiss from the wild gypsy's lips. I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy. Oh.